It is a real pleasure to introduce my conversation mates this afternoon, Dr. Maude Bass-Krueger, who is currently joining us from Belgium. She is a historian who thinks and writes about visual and material culture, notably as it relates to fashion and architecture. Since 2019, she has been an assistant professor at the University of Ghent in the Department of Art History, Music, and Theater Studies. She teaches classes on fashion and architecture, heritage, and exhibition history and theory. Dr. Bass-Krueger received a BA and an MA in history from Wesleyan University and Sciences Po, Paris, respectively, and PhD in decorative arts, design, history, and material culture from the Bard Graduate Center in New York City. She co-curated the exhibition Mode et Femme 1418 at the Bibliothèque Fournet in 2017, and the American iteration French Fashion, Women, and the First World War at the Gallery of the Bard Graduate Center with our second speaker, Dr. Sophie Kurkdjian. Sophie is joining us from Paris this evening. Now, Dr. Kurkdjian is a specialist in the history of cultural industries and is currently working on the social, economic, and cultural history of clothing in contemporary times. She received her doctorate in history from the University of Paris and is a researcher at the Institute for the History of Present Time, where she has been leading the history and fashion research seminar since 2012, and is an associate researcher at the Centre de Histoire Sociale du Monde Contemporain. She co-curated the exhibition Maude et Femme 1418 at the Fournet Library in Paris in 2017, and the American iteration on which our exhibition Silk and Steel is built, French Fashion, Women, and the First World War, that was at the Gallery of the Bard Graduate Center. Doctors, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you.
Yes, it's a pleasure to be here.
Truly, the pleasure is all mine. Now, this is one of, this is not necessarily one of the lenses within which most of the World War era has been examined. Exploring World War I through this lens, as a matter of fact, is a real departure from the way we most often see the conflict examined. Can you both kind of say something more on this and what your aims were in your research and in creating such an exhibition?
Yes, well, this was actually this began about 12 years ago for me when I was a master's student at Sciences Po. And I realized that although much had been written about the First World War in France, I mean, an incredible amount of scholarship has come out about the war, that there was very little on women and there was absolutely nothing on fashion. So I began to research and I thought that it was perhaps because there was a dearth of material, and that proved to be far from the case. And I really found an overwhelming amount of really incredible material. And the more I dug and the more I saw and learned, I realized that there really was quite a story to tell. And so when Sophie and I began working together about maybe a decade later, we were able to bring forward this material in a conference and an exhibition and to really show the things that had been uncovered.
Sophie, do you want to add anything to that?
No, just maybe that, yes, when we started to work on this exhibition, it was for the national commemoration of World War I, and that it was a good moment to do something on World War I in fashion, and that because there was nothing at that time, no one has proposed in 2014 something on fashion during World War I. So it was for us a big opportunity, and we managed to work with some national institutions which were committed to highlight some events related to the war. So it was a good opportunity at the right moment to work for this exhibition.
And as someone who has done a lot of work, not only on the American side of the centennial of World War I, but someone who continues to endeavor in those spaces, thank you. This really does give us a brand new way to look at this time frame, and one that is really easy to understand, particularly in our present space of also enduring a global pandemic. Now, you both talk about how fashion and the French fashion industry was integral to French morale and identity. Could you expand on this?
Well, I think it's important to know that the French fashion industry was the second largest industry in France at the beginning of the First World War, and it still is today. So it was an industry that generated hundreds of millions of francs at the time, euros today, francs then, and employed hundreds of thousands of men and women, and really kept the French economy afloat, and was also a way to boost French morale, and was kind of a soft power for France, as Sophie explores in her work, a major selling point for France. And so it was incredibly important that the French fashion industry continued during the war, not only for the economics, but also for French morale. And on the other hand, fashion was a way for women, men and women, to express their identity, but also express anxiety that they had about the war or about transformed gender relations. And it was a space for women to demand social reforms in terms of work. So it really was it was a space where a lot came together in 4 years.
Yes,
Sophie, do you want to add something?
Exactly, and this is what we saw in the archives, that in fact fashion was not only in the fashion magazines but everywhere in the magazines that the soldiers were reading, in different kind of material, and it meant a lot. It means that fashion was not only about a garment. It was more than that. It was social, cultural, economic. It was about politics. And during the entire period of the war, fashion is so important at different level, as Maude said. And this is really fascinating to use this lens to understand what happened between men and women, for example, and how really, as Maude said, that it crystallized a lot of anxieties, tensions, and fashion is a very good lens or prism to understand that. And yeah, this is really a perfect space of study, in fact.
So you are alluding to the fact that it does respond, and I know that you also have some beautiful photographs behind this opening slide here. So I'm going to ask a broader question, and Sophie, if you want to start speaking to it, fabulous. And I know that those in the who are watching are really going to be looking forward to, as I was, as my jaw dropped looking at some of these photos a little bit earlier. How did fashion respond to this conflict?
Sophie, I have this image for us.
Yes, so this is exactly how we can summarize both the exhibition, but also how we can answer your question. So this is a photo on the left, taken in July 1914, and showing a woman at the races at Boulogne or something like that. And she's wearing this long and very tight dress with a big hat. This is really the fashion of the Belle Époque. And on the right, you have the photo of July 1919. And this is three women still at the races, but wearing, as you can see, a shorter dress. And you can see this is two photos taken by the same photographer before and after the war. And you have like a kind of summary of what happened. And this is more complex, of course. This is not only this question of a dress who is shorter at the end, but this is a good image to summarize what happened to fashion, how it became more simple, how it was, it's a kind of a beginning of a democratization of fashion, both on the textile used to make fashion, but also a kind of simplification for the body to move in the dress with the dress. So this is one of the first answers we can have, because it's so big, it's so huge. This is not only, and this is what is fascinating, is that the war didn't have only one answer, or fashion didn't only have one answer. It's more than that, and it's not black and white. This is more gray, and this is not only about amplification, democratization of fashion. This is more complex. I don't know, Maude, if you want to talk about that.
I think one of the major points that Sophie and I make in this exhibition is that major changes happened to fashion during these 4 years, but these changes were already in place before the war began. And we see this even today with the pandemic, when we're often asked to think about how fashion is changing in relationship to the First World War. I mean, journalists love to call us and to ask us these questions. And one of the things I always say is that these changes that occur have been put in place, but the major economic shifts that are brought on by the war or by the pandemic really crystallize and move these changes forward in a more rapid way than they may have had these events not occurred. So hemlines were already rising before the war, styles were becoming more minimal, there was a freer movement, there were already styles that didn't have corsets. All of these were happening before the war, but the war really accelerated these changes and kind of cemented them into place.
And the same holds true actually for American fashion, right? You do have that movement of some of those changes happening, but when in the United States, we sent tens of thousands of women overseas and we went from a standing army of about 120,000 to over 4 million who are serving, we had to build uniforms for men, but also women, because women served across our armed forces. And when they sent women overseas, they didn't know what to do about and how to systematize undergarments. So they actually just gave women a stipend to buy undergarments from France. And that actually really set a lot of changes away from corsets inside the United States. Now, this is an exquisite dress. Maude, could you tell us some more about this?
So we have, in terms of fashion, there were a great many number of couture houses that were popular and profitable in the pre-war and wartime period. And several of them, many of them in fact, were led by women. Women were kind of the foremost business women of the day. They were female fashion designers were some of the most powerful business women, truly. I mean, they were leading multinational corporations with hundreds of employees. And of these powerful women-led fashion houses, a few are still in operation today. And we're lucky that they are, because those are the ones that have kept their archives. So we have Chanel and we have Lanvin. And so at Lanvin, Sophie and I had the fortune of going into the archives and seeing what is still preserved at the house of Lanvin, Jeanne Lanvin, the designer. And we saw dresses from the immediate pre-war period. And here is one example, feuille morte, or dead leaf in English, from the summer of 1914, so before the war breaks out. And you can see that there's a simplification, but there is kind of a fanciness that we no longer have during the war. So you have an embroidered collar with two materials, so a silk tulle, with the silk trim, and you have this really bright green sash with tassels. And then, I don't know if I have the other Lanvin dresses here. I think they might come later. Sorry, it's hard to have a presentation and an informal talk at the same time. So let me just, Sophie, this is okay. A Lanvin, correct?
Yes, it's a Lanvin dress,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, well, this is a wartime Lanvin. And so you see that that there's the wartime silhouette, which is really kind of an A-line crinoline silhouette in one fabric. So here it's a silk thigh and it's lined in fur to keep warm. So we have, this is an amazing Lanvin dress. Sophie, you want to talk about this dress?
Yeah. So it's a dress from Lanvin from 1917. So really a dress made during the war. And what is interesting is that this is a dress. You can see it. It's this is more simple. This is a dress which is more simple than the feuille d'automne that we saw just before. So you can see that there is that the war has an impact on fashion, on the dress. This dress is easy to wear. What is also interesting is that it's a size, I think size 44 in Europe, in France, And this dress is called Madame, and the archivist at Lanvin thinks that that Madame Lanvin created this dress for herself and that she wore this dress during the war and maybe after. So this is also interesting to have this kind of, you know, intimate information on this. And for us, what was very important is that this dress with this color of the national flag, the blue, the white, and the red, was also a symbol of the patrie and of France. And this was a patriotic dress, or at least a dress which was really supporting the war effort. And the third element is that this dress has pockets, and it can seem normal to you, but in fact it was pretty new to have pockets in dresses and in skirts. So we will have other image where you can see that, but this was really new to have pockets. First woman who needed pockets was the nurses who needed to work and have pockets, but then pockets appeared on this casual dress like this one.
No, I know that there's also some other, Maude, go ahead.
No, these are just some more Lanvin dresses from the war. I mean, it was one of the most impressive archives of wartime couture that we found, because there aren't many couture dresses from this period that have survived. So this was really a pretty incredible archive.
And the colors are so vibrant.
Yeah, like the fashion plates we can have from that period, like Les Élégances Parisiennes or La Gazette du Bon Ton, we have this kind of blue and green. Mm-hmm. And this is what we use for the New York exhibition, this the same color, because it was really the color we find in the press at that time.
Now, there's another house as well that you spoke to that also created some changes, right? Pockets may seem like a more natural addition to women's fashion today, but jersey material is another one that we think of. Could you expand on that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Why don't you talk while I find some images?
Yes. So the jersey is a very interesting point, because jersey has always existed since the Middle Ages. It existed, but jersey was used to make underwear. It was not a very soft and nice textile. It was used for underwear, for leisure dresses, but not at all for daily dress. And a young hat maker, Gabrielle Chanel, completely unknown at the time, bought some jersey to the textile industrial called Rodier in France. She found a stock, like a lot of jersey that the Rodier didn't want to use. She bought the textile stock, and she decided to make daily wear with jersey, and it was the first. And she made a first skirt suit, and it was the first skirt suit in jersey in the history of fashion. And it's true that she managed to produce very practical clothes thanks to the jersey textile, that the suit were really maybe easy to put and to wear. And she also created these blues that you can see here. This is in jersey de soie, so jersey of silk or silk of jersey. I don't know how I can say that in English, but this blues is really iconic. First, because it's made in jersey, so it's the first time, but also because you see the first document that the Maison Chanel has kept from the beginning of Chanel. They have nothing except this blouse and a hat that we have in the exhibition too. And this is a sailor blouse, so influenced by the sailors from the war. And this is really a masterpiece, which is now on display in Paris, because there we have an exhibition on Chanel since 2 weeks. And this blouse is like an iconic garment, like a treasure for Chanel.
And here it's funny, because this image comes to us from Chanel, this promotional image. Mm-hmm. And the way that they've mannequined the blouse is on a black mannequin body with nothing underneath. Women, Chanel herself, would not have worn this blouse that way. There would have, as you can see in the image on the left, she would have had an undershirt and an undershirt. it would not have been open down to the chest bones.
That's a good clarification.
Yeah, and what we saw also is that, you know, the storytelling of Chanel is very, very, very important because, yes, Chanel used jersey and she managed to do something new, but other couturiers were using jersey at that time too. So, yes, she did something new, but she was not the only one. But today we remember only that Chanel was the first one to use jersey. So this is also interesting because this garment... very old garment is used to say something about the brand, about the brand DNA today. So this is really part of the storytelling today, still today.
Now, you mentioned that it was going to be on display. If someone happens to be in and or around Paris, where is that new exhibition going to be opening?
Oh, this is at the Palais Galliera, so the fashion museum. It was closed during 3 years and it's a new museum, like new one, because everything... There is a new part in the museum funded by Chanel, and the opening exhibition is a Chanel exhibition, of course.
So, audience, if you find yourself, whether or not you are watching this live or on YouTube later on, feel free to go find out more about that exhibition as well, where they probably go into a little bit more of that information. The jersey was in part so available to other couturiers because, like present day, people wanted to provide their athletes, right? And soldiers are your athletes with the very best that material and science could provide so that they could go the extra mile. And most militaries at that point in time recognized that wool was going to be a better performing material, both in the heat and in the wintertime. So across a lot of nations, you have militaries that are now clothing all of these primarily men, and they are shifting to wool. So if you go through our main gallery space, you're going to see a lot of wool materials because they really believed, and it is true, it functions in a wonderful way, very warm in the heat of the summer, but it does function very well, those wool materials, which is what provided that surplus for beautiful designs like this one and others that Sophie mentioned.
Well, in the US, there may have been a surplus of wool, but in France, there wasn't. There was a dearth.
Ooh. Yes, I apologize. It's not the surplus of wool. It's a surplus of jersey. Thank you.
Right. So jersey is a technique. Mm-hmm. And so it can either be made from wool or it can be made from silk. So it's the way that the warp and the weft are knit together. So on the left, you have the wool jersey that Chanel is wearing, which would have been actually rather expensive because wool was really expensive during the war. The Germans bombarded the northeastern regions of France where all the textile industries were producing and transforming fiber into fabric. And so the price of wool just went up drastically during the war and it became quasi unaffordable, whereas that of silk, which was produced in Lyon, so a city in the center of France, which was far from the enemy lines, actually became the most affordable fabric during the war. So there is an overproduction, or there's a large availability of silk and silk jerseys. And most garments during the war are made of silk because that's what was actually the cheapest and with the most availability, but what is not the warmest. So by 1918, 1919, that really became, or 1917, 1918, that really became a problem because people needed new coats and they needed warmer garments and wool was really unaffordable.
Now, more than 100 years later, we've already spoken to some of those other sartorial shifts. Are there others that you would want to speak to during the period?
Well, I just flipped onto this image. So the tailored suit or the skirt suit, I guess we call it was called a tailored suit, costume tailleur. Women didn't wear pants. So it was de facto a skirt. But it really was kind of the uniform of the rear, l'uniforme de l'arrière in French, maybe it sounds better, I guess.
It almost always sound better in French, just here.
But it was really the garment that women across all social classes wore. And I think that as historians, Sophie and I are both interested not only in couture and what the elite and the wealthy women could afford, but really what the working class, middle class, and lower class women could afford, and what people were wearing and what women wore to work and throughout the day was the tailored suit ensemble. And so we found some great examples, some which were more luxurious and, you know, here made from velvet. I think it's a silk velvet. So again, velvet is a technique. So silk velvet with a fur trim. Here's a tailored jacket on the right. It's a women's tailored jacket that has borrowed patterns and insignia and from male uniform. And here, Sophie and I, we're always so excited when we found objects in collections, garments that were from department stores. So department stores were still a novelty in 1914, even though they had existed since 1850. 1852 was the first department store. Women still preferred to get their clothes tailored by their local couturière. And this was the case in France up until the 1960s. So department stores existed and they sold garments for a more affordable price, but they weren't always, well, women were quite unsure about department stores. So it was always a great find when we found examples of tailored suits in department stores. And here, both of these are from Parisian archives. And then we also, maybe Sophie, do you wanna talk about what working women wore?
Oh yeah, yeah. So yeah, yes, because what we wanted, what we absolutely wanted for this exhibition and books was to talk, of course, about the elite and the aristocracy and the haute couture. But we really wanted to talk about those women at work. So women were, like 9 million of French women were working before the war. So this was not new during the war. But what was new is that for the first time, a woman replaced men and were in charge of new jobs that they have never had before. So for the first time, they became driver of train. They became, this one was driving a car. The other one was working in a train station, and she was, it's too technical but for me, but she was an aiguilleuse de train. So she was working in the train station. And those photos are really showing this woman at work. Oh, this one, it was maybe our favorite photo. It was so amazing. This is on a Parisian rooftop. And so we can see that they are...
Chimney sweep.
Voila, yes, exactly. And you can see how it was new for them. Alors, so of course, those photos are maybe, they are posing for the photo. So yes, maybe it's only about propaganda, maybe, of course. But if you look closely at those photos, this is amazing what you can see. You can see those women who were replacing men and called remplaçant. She was there only to replace men. And we will understand why. Because in 1918, when men came back from the front, women can't continue to work like before. They have to go home and to give their job back. So they were called les remplaçants. So that explains why they didn't have any outfit for them. They have to borrow those overalls from their brother or their dad or their husband who are at the front. So we can see how those overalls was not very suitable for their body. What is also interesting is that on each and this image, you can see how you can see pearl necklace, the lace collar, you can see some rings, some jewelry, and you can see how elegant they were and it was important for them to look elegant, to look fancy, to look chic. Those women came from the middle class, so they didn't have a lot of money, but it was important to wear, to show that behind the overall or the work uniform, they were feminine, or at least they were wearing necklace, jewelries, and woman attires. So those photos are really amazing. This is a French photo from the French institution, and it's, you can see all the women jobs during World War One.
I mean, and the fact that the women weren't granted uniforms from 1914 until 1917. So this changes in 1917. There are a few designers who begin to make work outfits for women. But the fact that the French government refused to allow women at the beginning of the war proper uniforms for the jobs that they were taking over was very political. French women were on the verge of obtaining the right to vote in 1914. And when the war broke out, suffragettes shelved their demands and put the nation above the desire to vote. That doesn't really make sense in English, but you understand what I mean. So they
something happened similar inside the United States, though. We ratified the 19th Amendment, which allowed many, but not all, women inside the United States the right to vote in 1920. They put a halt to their actions. Yeah.
Exactly. So the U.S. ratifies in 1920, right? So during the war, American women, like French women, serve the nation, and you know they obtain what they demand after the war, and in large part thanks to the war. But this is not the case in France. French women do not vote they obtain the right to vote in 1944, correct, Sophie? And then they vote for the first time in 1945.
Yeah.
And so the French government really used this question of uniforms for the remplaçantes as a way to quell feminist female demands. If women wore uniforms like men, they would have more of the same rights as men. And they would have I don't speak English that often at the moment, but they would have more of a right to demand the right to vote after the war. So the fact that they were taking these men's jobs was already problematic. The government didn't want to allow them to also wear uniforms like the men, which is why they wore what they had in their closets, and they had hats and armbands that indicated their jobs. So men in these roles would have worn standardized uniforms that were given to them by their boss.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you have the opportunity to go through, and I unfortunately did not have it queued up and for an informal conversation, we have a beautiful pant suit for a female doctor that was serving. And it really is one of those first examples of an American woman, you know, at the time that a reputable woman could be wearing pants. And it is that forward motion, walking into the future. And Woodrow Wilson absolutely speaks to, in 1919, he says in a speech to Congress that it is women's work in the World War. Would we invite them into the sacrifice of the war and not give them the opportunity for fuller citizenship? And if you are watching live or on the recording, you can find out more about that in our exhibition, Votes and Voices, which is currently on display at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. And we have a lot of really wonderful kind of encyclopedic articles on women in World War I that kind of delve into more of that American side. And I really hope that we can delve a bit more into the global side with you all afterwards and get some more of this conversation.
Let me just say that that's a huge difference between French women, American women, and British women. Mm-hmm. British women and American women were enabled to enlist in female corps, and they had uniforms, and French women were not allowed to, and they did not have uniforms. So that's a huge difference.
Mm-hmm. And there's a wonderful book, if any of you are interested in looking a bit more into that, by Mona Siegel. It's called Peace on Our Terms, and she is looking at the global advance of suffrage for women, and looks at kind of all of those varying factors, and not just within Europe or North America. She looks at the Middle East as well. She provided some wonderful lectures that are on our YouTube channel, but always go back to books. And already I'm going to answer one of the questions that we've been given on Facebook Live about a catalog And I'm going to show this to you again. This would be the place that she went to go, French fashion, women, and the First World War. It has been printed by Yale Press. And I think you could probably find this from some of your independent book sellers. That might be a good place to go for more information. Now, Maude, you've pulled up something else really beautiful.
Well, it's just to illustrate the difference and the paradox between what the French women are allowed to do and what they're allowed to wear and what the Americans are. And American women who enlisted in female corps were allowed to wear uniforms that were regulated by the American Army. They could buy these uniforms in French department stores in Paris, but French women were not allowed to buy these. These were made for Americans, and they were sold in Paris to Americans, but not to French women.
And this is in part why I love conversations like this, because they always learn something new. Now, before we head into one of our final questions and open it up to Q&A, is there anything else in that sector? And we've already talked a bit more about conceptions of gender. Is there anything else that you want to share about kind of conceptions of gender and how women's fashion speaks to that in particular?
Wait, Sophie, I have the shell casings. Do you want to talk about
that? Oh, yes, it would be great. Yes, so it something was that we saw when we were doing our research in the archives is that, in fact, we found these shell cases. And most of the time, shell cases are engraved with floral patterns, erotical patterns. But we found this one, and those ones are about fashion. These three ones are about fashion, the evolution of fashion from 1914 to 1919. And it's one soldier who engraved these shell cases and who represented the evolution of fashion. And it has different meanings. And what is interesting is that, in fact, fashion was so important, even for men at the front. They received each day a journal des tranchées, a trend journal. And in those trend journal, fashion was depicted, commented, and the evolution of fashion when there were two silhouettes during the war, and women changed fashion. They earn a little bit more money because of their new job. So there were a lot of differences in the way women lived during the war. And all these novelties changes are on those shell cases or are in the press. So we can see how fashion was something women were worried about. Fashion was, the change in fashion meant something. They saw the changes in fashion as, for example, a woman requests to have more freedom or to have more money or more responsibility. And we can see in this caricature that you can see here, how soldiers were, because all these caricatures were published in journal, published by men, the caricatures were men, so it's really a male gaze. And all these caricatures are either making love of women because they are following fashion, that they are very fancy, and they only spend their time in buying new clothes. So, or this caricature, criticize women and blame them being too boyish, mm-hmm. and smoking, drinking, and women are either shallow or masculine, and for them something is wrong, something is going wrong, because it was not the case in 1914, so the war is responsible of that, and fashion is really the lens where they can see these changes happening.
I mean, I think one of the most impressive things that we realized is that fashion was everywhere, and discussions about fashion were absolutely everywhere. So as Sophie says, whether they're in the trench journals that the soldiers are reading weekly in the trenches, whether they're on the postcards that are being sent back and forth, whether fashion representations are being engraved on shell casings, whether it's written about in the newspaper, I mean, there's barely a media space in France during these 4 years where fashion isn't invoked. And when it is invoked, it's sometimes about the fashion itself, so about the changes in the silhouettes, but more often it says something else, and it talks about anxieties, about the new jobs that women have, the new money that they have, as Sophie says, anxieties about changed gender relations, whether women are forgetting the men, you know, are they too fancy and too frivolous, and does that mean that they've forgotten the men? Or you know, fear and sadness. I mean, we can also talk about mourning. If we're talking about great sadness and how mourning was discussed during the war, it wasn't as simple as just women are in mourning. I mean, a woman who wore black, of course she was exhibiting great pain in doing so in a way that society required of her. So mourning dress was still something that was required to be worn. But on the other hand, a woman in black, especially a young woman wearing black, was signaling that she was newly available on the market. And in a country that lost so many men, and that was so preoccupied with birth rates, I think we say.
Yeah, and that's birth rates, and that's birth rates. Yeah, some military historians I know say that some of the key battles of World War II were actually lost because of some of the great battles of World War I, between 1 in 3 Frenchmen between the ages of 18 and 30 were lost within the first within just the first few years of the war, which is it's devastating to so many aspects of life. So you very much are speaking to that.
Yeah, and you know, it really was a catch-22 for women. So they were required. I mean, everybody lost somebody, whether it was a husband, a brother, a partner, a son. I mean, there was a tremendous sadness, and one expressed one's sadness through one's clothing, through mourning dress, and in ways that were very rigidly organized. But on the other hand, these women were really harshly criticized for being frivolous mourners or fashionable mourners. Here we have le deuil correct, so the correct way to wear mourning, and dare a woman step outside of these conventions, she was immediately criticized. And you know, the younger the mourner and the more ostentatious her black mourning, then the more she was likely to be thought of as a prostitute, you know, standing on the corner. What's this woman doing in black, standing alone on the corner of Denfert Rochereau? You know, this is a really ambiguous photograph. In a way that this isn't.
Right. You know?
So these older women are gathering, drinking beers and socializing and mourning, this is an unambiguous photograph, whereas this is really sexually charged.
Yeah, because it is in fact a woman, which already speaks to a lot of complexity in gender. We have, and I'm gonna shift to our last question, and then we've got several really good questions that I wanna get to. We have a lot of complexities going on right now in our present day that make some of this time frame easier to understand. We have a global pandemic that has in many ways shut down so many parts of economy that has changed how we do our normals all around the world. Was there some expression of that then? Are there some connections that we can make to changes in fashion then, and how or if there are changes occurring in fashion today?
Yes, I can start. Yes, I think it's we can really make a lot of comparisons, and this is what happened when at least in Paris, when the lockdown started in March. Many journalists wanted to write article on the crisis and understand what will happen to fashion, and I ask historians like what happened in the past, and it's true that we can try to understand what happened today looking back at World War One and World War Two. What is clear is that fashion is today impacted by the COVID crisis at different level, at the production one, dissemination one, and the consumption one. And that really, since the beginning, fashion is in crisis. Since March, fashion is in crisis, and the fashion weeks have been canceled. And it means a lot for Paris or New York not to have the international buyers coming to buy a lot of fashions, garments. This is a very important for the reputation of Paris, because as Maude said, it's fashion is really a tool of soft power, but it's also a very big problem for the Bangladesh and all those workers who are not paid and who can't work anymore because all those fast fashion brands have canceled their orders. This is also a lot of changes in the way we consume clothes and fashion, how we buy, what we want to buy. And so, yes, for me, we can make what happened during World War One and today is not at all the same, of course, but we can really find similarities between them. What we can see also is that after World War One, we have the 20s, and this is the first golden age of fashion. After World War II, this is the second golden age of fashion with Christian Dior. So the question of the journalist was, will we have a third golden age of fashion? But I'm not sure. For me, I think that what's happening today is more like concern more people, and I'm not sure that fashion will be the same after, and that we will have the same evolution than we have in the past.
But you know, on an optimistic note, French fashion survived the First World War, and it survived the Second World War, and I mean, in a way, it has to survive this current crisis. It's too great of an economic powerhouse. So, you know, then there are these, if you go through the archives, you can see some, you know, very spot on parallels between 1918 and today. So flu veils, for instance, here, you know, chiffon veils may have become compulsory during the Spanish influenza epidemic in New York. And I found another, so here again, so what kind of veils, how fashionable your veils are, so your you know, what our masks are today. The veils now being, so this is from October 1918, the veils now being chosen take on the color of the hat. There are henna veils and veils of taupe, brown, blue, and purple to match the hats with which they are worn. You know, just like we're matching our hats, our masks to our clothes today. And then I found this one kind of made me laugh. How this is from 1918 as well. How the sale of negligees, so indoor wear, was really soaring during the first months of the pandemic. You know, like today, as we all are buying more sweatpants and
leisure wear. And indoor wear.
At the time, the negligee sales were going up. So, you know, there are these direct parallels between the Spanish flu influenza of 1918 and today, and as Sophie says, on verra, you know, will there be a resurgence? I mean, only time will tell. So, you know, we're living through it. It's tough to say. We know what's happened in the past, but, you know, historians can't predict the future. So Sophie and I we study the past and we'll see.
That's it.
And as someone else who does, I always find, I find history to be a great source of optimism as well. Maude, as you mentioned, that there is this response, and Sophie, as you mentioned, that there is kind of this not just a response, but that there's a shift kind of in some of that creativity and the like to address what the new concerns and what that new feel and the era is. Now we've got three questions, and I'm going to ask them very quickly, and I will be looking for concise answers as best you can. So I'm not sure who is going to be better equipped to answer this one. These are a lot of really complex garments. Susan Jackson on Zoom asks, how were these garments cleaned?
Do you mean, sorry, Susan, do you mean in the day or when we exhibit them in today?
I think I am going to think back then.
Well, dry cleaning did not exist. So water and savon de Marseille, very carefully, very delicately, but also not very often. People certainly did not clean their clothes as often as we clean their clothes. And, you know, the sweat stains that we find in garments are testament to that.
Yeah.
So.
Now, Martha Burnett, and you had a beautiful picture of this. I think it was one of the first pictures that you showed of the Belle Epoque and then post-war. Martha Burnett on Zoom asked, I've always been curious about the women's shoes worn during this period. The T-strap and the Mary Jane seem to be prevalent. Can you briefly explain how this came to be? Merci.
This is something I know very little about.
Yeah, Sophie, me too. Just the thing I can say is that, I don't know if we have images of that, but that women use kind of textile protection to protect the shoes. So we say guêtre in French. I don't know in English, but we found one pair of shoes during our research.
Gaiters.
Gaiters.
Yeah, so the kind of like the fabric that you put over the shoe to protect the shoe.
Oh, yes. Yep.
So it was really practical reason. For me, it's the only thing I know about shoes. I don't know a lot, and we didn't find a lot of shoes, in fact.
It is one of actually the more challenging things to obtain within the collection as well, because people continue to use the shoes, right? If it's a well-crafted shoe, you keep using it. And so we're always thrilled when we receive that as an object donation. I'm going to actually ask two. Great timing, Pat. Here we go. Very quickly, this is a yes, no answer. Pat Neffel, I hope I say your last name correctly. I was so impressed with the picture of the factory worker wearing a drop pearl necklace in the pictures you showed in your presentation. Is that common? Was it common to be wearing?
Propaganda, yes.
Yes. Great answer. And the last question is going to come from Marjorie de Rossier. I hope, again, I have done your surname justice. Was there fashion competition between the three branches of Croix Rouge Francais Women's Nursing Auxiliary Corps? That is, did social class and fashion inform their white uniform designs and footwear in any sort of distinct way?
There was a difference in social classes, but their uniforms weren't necessarily different. The nurses were the only ones who actually had a regulated uniform. That being said, there were huge differences in how you could obtain your uniform. So you could, for instance, go to Lanvin and obtain a pseudo nurse uniform if you had the funds.
And now inside the United States, the same is true. There are a lot of different ways that you could get a uniform. Abercrombie and Fitch and Stetson, they are two companies that you could have been using as a purveyor of your uniforms back at the time, not necessarily of female fashion, but certainly we've got some great examples of men's fashion. Barbara Woodson, sneaking in one last question. When did women start to wear pants?
Ooh, in France, Sophie, like what, mid-1950s, I would say?
Yeah, even 60s. Yeah, it was forbidden until to work in pants, so to go to work in pants until the early 70s. But it was allowed to have pants during the weekend. After 1963, but not before. It was completely forbidden.
Dr. Bass-Krueger, Dr. Kurkdjian, thank you so very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Belgium and France for this, at least in the United States, lunchtime conversation about French fashion, women, and fashioning gender in wartime. France, really a delight to spend this hour with you. I'd like to give my thanks to our supporting sponsor, PNC. Again, they have been working to support women's in industry and continue to do so, as well as support the cultural institutions that explore this and other types of history. If you want more information, do take a look at their catalog, French Fashion, Women, and the First World War, or go to our website, theworldwar.org, and check out Silk and Steel French Fashion, Women in World War I online, or visit us in Kansas City, Missouri, where we would welcome you to come into the space anytime Tuesday through Sunday and explore some beautiful fashion firsthand. Thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward
to your visit.
Thank you. Bon appétit, everybody.
Bon appétit, yes. Thank you. Bye.
We're going to go have a drink.
Yes.